I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and burned that. Man, the way that I live don't concern that. Man, we gon' have to settle this another way. A letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and burned that. Man, the way that I live don't concern that. Man, we gon' have to settle this.
Welcome to another edition of Critical Insight and Your World News. I'm your host, Solomon Kamajan. And today we're joined by author John Potash, author and activist and organizer John Potash. He's also the author of The FBI's War on Tupac Shakur and Black Leaders. And I wanted to first thank you, John, for taking some time out of your busy schedule to be with us today.
Thanks a lot, Solomon, for having me on your program.
Well, the first question I'd like to start off by asking, and it's an unbelievably powerful book that you wrote, very revealing and well put together with research, and you know, I know that there's another book that's coming out in November, and we'll get into that a little bit later in the interview. But one of the questions I'd like to talk about that your book addresses, could you get into Tupac Shakur and talk about his life, his background of his life prior to him becoming the hip hop icon that so many people know him about? Who were his close family members, and how did those relationships impact himself, his political activity, and even his music?
Sure. Well, it started with Saeedine Abba Shakur. The Shakur family was very important because they spanned the legacy of great black leaders. Saeedine Abba Shakur was a member of Marcus Garvey's organization, and he then became part of Malcolm X's Organization for African American Unity, and was part of Malcolm X's inner circle. And Abba Shakur basically adopted, he had sons, Lumumba Shakur and Zaid Shakur, and adopted other kids. And one of those kids he adopted was Matulu Shakur. And those younger Shakurs had joined Malcolm X's organization just before Malcolm X died. Now, another person that had joined Malcolm X's organization early on was a man named Eugene Roberts. And Gene Roberts was part of the Bureau of Special Services for the New York Police Department. And they overlapped the FBI with the FBI's counterintelligence program. And so Eugene Roberts was an undercover agent infiltrator. He ended up rising up in Malcolm X's security unit. And when Malcolm X was assassinated, I talk about in my book, his wife, Betty Shabazz, was there. Eugene Roberts had come with a woman named Joan Roberts. I don't know if it was his wife or his sister. But Eugene Roberts ended up being the first person that arrived at Malcolm X's body after he was shot. Now, Betty Shabazz was a nurse and tried to get to Malcolm X's body first. But Joan Roberts tried to hold her back while Eugene Roberts was running over there, and Betty Shabazz ended up throwing her against the wall and running to her husband's body. And there was Eugene Roberts saying that, you know, he's dead. Now, the importance of that is that with Martin Luther King's assassination, an undercover infiltrator named Merrill McConnell was the first person. Merrill McConnell was his name, was the first person to arrive in Martin Luther King's body when he was assassinated. And William Pepper, who was a friend of Martin Luther King's and had investigated for 25 years his assassination, said Merrill McConnell's job was to check on his life signs. And I argue that was the same job as Eugene Roberts, to make sure the assassination by U.S. intelligence was successful. So after after the assassination of Malcolm X, though, the Shakurs went different ways, but Lumumba and Zaid Shakur went and became part of the Black Panther Party. Lumumba Shakur started the Harlem Black Panthers in New York, and Zaid Shakur became a Minister of Information for the Bronx Black Panthers. So it was 1968 when Afeni Shakur, Tupac Shakur's mother, joined the Black Panther Party in Harlem and ended up marrying Lumumba Shakur. And they were attacked by, of course, the FBI's counterintelligence program. And while Afeni Shakur was elected to be the first person to be gotten out on bail, she ended up getting together with another Black Panther who she got pregnant with, and Lumumba Shakur divorced her at that point, but Afeni Shakur actually was elected head of the Harlem Black Panthers while Lumumba was in jail. And so she was a major black leader in the Harlem Panthers. And Tupac was born about 3 to 6 months after they gotten off in that famous trial of the Newark Panther 21. Afeni Shakur represented herself and did amazing work representing herself in court and was credited with getting all of the Panthers off in court. Tupac was born to that kind of family. And so he loved the Black Panthers, of course, grew up with the Black Panther extended family. And Asada Shakur was considered his godmother. And Geronimo Pratt, the head of the LA Panthers, was his godfather. And when a preacher asked him what he wanted to be when he grew up, when he was 13, he said a revolutionary. That's what he was about his whole life. He used to go, now his mother, Afeni, ended up moving in with Matula Shakur, Lumumba's adopted brother, in the 70s. And so Tupac saw Matula Shakur as his stepfather. Matula Shakur was a co-founder of the Republic of New Africa, which had convened in Detroit, Michigan, and was a national group of organizers, community organizers that convened in Detroit to start a new movement. And they were, of course, in solidarity with the Black Panthers. But the Black Panthers were so attacked that they pretty much died down in, you know, of course, 71 or 72 because of those attacks by the FBI, this counterintelligence program. Now, you know, Tupac knew of the FBI's counterintelligence program trying to kill his godfather, Geronimo Pratt, trying to imprison and kill, different than the New York Panther leaders. And now, when he got into junior high, he started attending a group called the New African People's Organization. That was founded by some former Black Panthers and former Republic of New Africa members. And that they had a group within the New African People's Organization called the New African Panthers, which were about the same age as the Black Panthers when they first started. By the time Tupac turned 17 years old, he was elected chairman of the New African Panthers. And so he was already a national black leader before he became a rapper. New African Panthers were active in 8 cities nationwide. Tupac was considered the top newspaper salesman in California. And, this comes from Chokwe Lumumba, who was head of the New African People's Organization, the great lawyer, and who was elected mayor of Jackson, Mississippi, who died a few months ago. Now, Chokwe Lumumba became Tupac's national lawyer, and his business manager when he became a rapper was Watani Tayahimba, who was the co-founding national security director for the New African People's Organization. So after he spent about a year being chairman of the New African Panthers, he decided that he was going to leave that leadership position to tour with Digital Underground. Watani Tayahimba and Chokwe Lumumba said he just felt that he could get the message out, his activist message out more through rap than he could in what he was doing with the New African People's Organization and, being chair of New African Panthers. So it was at that point that he started becoming famous with Digital Underground and then landed a debut album that the real serious attacks, murderous attacks occurred, I argue. And if you want me to get into that, I can go into the attacks, immediately, or if you want to ask me anything else about the legacy, you're welcome to.
Yeah, I'd like to. You mentioned a couple times, and you mentioned COINTELPRO and mm-hmm. Mentioned the FBI. Could you talk a little bit more about the role that the FBI and other U.S. Organs played in terrorizing and destabilizing the black community and some of the sure. more high-profile assassinations that were committed?
Yeah, well, probably the highest-profile assassination was the assassination of Fred Hampton, and that occurred in Chicago. And some of the details of that came out in court. It came out that this undercover agent, I believe his name was Eugene O'Neill, and infiltrated the Chicago Black Panthers and put pills in the Kool-Aid Chairman Fred Hampton and another Panther leader named Mark Clark. And so they were, when police shot up their home and came in, including with a machine gun, and shot directly at the Chicago Black Panthers, they were basically unconscious. Mark Clark and Fred Hampton were unconscious. Fred Hampton was in his bed. He wasn't even woken up by the bullets being shot at his home. And they shot him in his bed and dragged his body out of his bed. It was absolutely horrible. And the Hamptons won a settlement in court on that, but that was the most brutal of the murders. They also, I argue that they also, they had Huey Newton's license plate number when they stopped him and a shootout occurred. They planned murderous attacks on a number of Panthers. Now, we don't know about all the attacks, but with the death of a number of Panthers, there's a lot of evidence that they were planned by the FBI. They also manufactured fake letters between Panther leaders to create dissent between different leaders. They had infiltrated the Panthers all over the country. But one of the key infiltrators, I argue, is controversial, but it was an infiltrator that got close with Huey Newton and influenced him. A few infiltrators got close to Huey Newton and influenced him to kick out Geronimo Pratt from the Black Panther Party and to have a kind of discord with the New York Black Panthers and have disagreements with Eldridge Cleaver. And so that created more tensions and more conflicts and more problems. But they came in, the police came in shooting in a number of Panther headquarters around the country. They shot up Geronimo Pratt's bed, for example, but he was sleeping on the floor due to a back problem when he was in the Vietnam War. So they tried to kill a number of Panther leaders.
Right, thank you.
Of course, another horrible death was the murder of Zaid Shakur when he got so terrified of the counterintelligence program against the Black Panthers. He went underground and formed the Black Liberation Army, and Assad Shakur ended up joining him underground. And they stopped Zaid and Assad's car on the highway, and a shootout ensued, and Zaid was killed. Sundi Adakali went to jail, and Assad Shakur was shot but didn't die. And, of course, they accused Assad of shooting the police, and all evidence says she didn't. But she ends up, having to be, she was broken out of jail, they say, by Mutula Shakur and a few other great activists. And, we don't know for sure, but she's now in Cuba, actually hiding out because they still have I think it's $1 million bounty on her head. She was the first woman to be on the Terrorist Most Wanted list recently. I think she was put on that list about a year or two ago.
Thank you. Can you talk about Tupac Shakur's activist legacy? Because I think that's really something important that folks should know about.
Sure. So after Tupac became, head of the New African Panthers and then broke into rap, he was immediately attacked, but he also decided to take on a new activist agenda. And that was to try to gain peace truces between the Bloods and the Crips. That started just around the time of the L.A. riots when, of course, Rodney King was shown on film being beaten by police and the police were acquitted in court. So Los Angeles rioted. There was riots in other parts of the country, too. And around that time, Tupac decided to, the Bloods and Crips were calling peace truces between each other and turning it on to activism. And Tupac's Black Panther extended family was helping that happen. And Tupac decided to take on this fake gangster persona in order to appeal to more gang members and politicize them. And he was actually meeting up with Bloods and Crips leaders at peace truce picnics and having them come together officially to call peace truces at different places in California. Now, this was actually spreading throughout the country to the point that it came to New York. The Young Lords helped the Latin Kings turn on to activism, and they stopped drug dealing and doing other things and got into activism. And, of course, they were targeted for doing that, but they were the largest gang in New York, about 3,000 strong. So it was having a major effect, and it's too bad that Tupac was still known as that gangster versus being known for what he really was, which was a very serious left-wing activist.
Thank you. And so, you know, when we look at that, the context that you've just laid out, the biographical, you know, sketch that you've laid out in regards to Tupac Shakur, his family members, people that are close to him, people that played a major role in terms of influence him politically and you know, with his activist work and otherwise. Can you talk about the increased sophistication of tactics that were, you know, that came with the increased wealth and fame?
Sure.
For Tupac?
Yeah. Now, when he first broke, he got a solo record, deal with Interscope. His first song to be released was Trapped. It came out, it was an MTV worldwide release. Within several days of MTV playing this political video, Trapped, of his, police stopped him in Oakland, California. They said for jaywalking, and they proceeded to pound his head against the curb and then choke him unconscious. And I found articles of people dying in police custody from those two tactics. Now, police, now Tupac survived that and won a settlement for that police brutality. The next incident that happened after that was at his film premiere. There was a drive-by shooting on his limousine that Tupac survived. And I show a case where undercover police had done a drive-by against an important witness against police brutality and were caught doing that drive-by. Someone recognized the cops and their car and found out that they were police pretending to be just normal civilians doing a drive-by shooting. And the third incident that happened to Tupac was at the Marin City Fest. He was invited as an honorary guest, and strangers came up to him out of nowhere when he was signing autographs, and one of them punched Tupac, and the other took out a gun and shot at him. And Matulu Shakur got a gun to try to ward off these attackers and just shot straight in the air, according to eyewitnesses. But Tupac was almost killed in that incident, and police were there right at the event watching and did nothing except eventually to arrest Matulu and Tupac. It was Mupreme Harding, who was Matulu's son, who was there bodyguarding Tupac, and he's the one that grabbed a gun from and shot in the air to try to ward off the attackers. But police arrested Mupreme Harding and Tupac and not the attackers. And the importance of these three incidents is that they all happened while Richard Held was the supervisor in the San Francisco Bay Office area. He had formerly been head of the Los Angeles COINTELPRO unit that had tried to kill Geronimo Pratt, Tupac's godfather. And Tupac had been working on Geronimo Pratt's freedom, just as his mother was, to try to do work to get Geronimo Pratt freed, which she eventually was in 1997. But Richard Held came to the San Francisco Bay Area to try to stop that legal defense team from having success, which it was having success in getting Geronimo Pratt free. And another thing that Richard Held was accused of, and there's a lot of evidence that he really did it, was that Huey Newton was assassinated in 1989. And people say it was over a botched drug deal, but the police and Richard Held were caught lying about the details of that assassination. And I show eyewitness testimony of people that heard what was happening and looked out their window to see Huey Newton get assassinated. And the way they described it wasn't a botched drug deal. It looked like a typical assassination. One shot to put Huey Newton on the ground and then two shots in the head to make sure the assassination was successful. So here was Richard Held supervising the area where Tupac's attacked three times. And that and other evidence I show, I think, point to U.S. intelligence involvement in assassinating Tupac before he became even bigger. So after those three attacks, Tupac, records kept selling more and more. You know, they went from gold status to platinum status to double platinum status. And in Atlanta, when in 1993, Tupac was coming out of a concert on, I think it was close to Halloween night. And there was a strange incident where two supposedly off-duty cops were harassing a black man in a car right near Tupac. And according to eyewitnesses, Tupac rolled down his window and said, "What's going on?" And these two white Atlanta police officers ran over Tupac's car, smashed his car window with a butt of their gun, and then shot at him. Tupac rolled out the back of his car because he was in the back seat, rolled out the back, grabbed his bodyguard's gun, and shot back at them. And they proceeded to start running because Tupac's whole entourage got out of their car when they saw these, you know, white guys running over Tupac's car and screaming. And so they started running with their gun pointed backwards, according to witnesses. So Tupac was merely trying to defend himself and shot them in the butt and the legs as they were running off. Now, police immediately came to Tupac's hotel room right after that, despite that Tupac was in his hotel room under an alias. So they were monitoring him very closely, coming immediately to his hotel room and arresting him for this. But he got let off in court for shooting these two white guys because all the witnesses said that, you know, these guys attacked first and shot first. So they also found out that the gun that they shot at Tupac with was stolen from an evidence locker, their police evidence locker. And another cop in a separate trial called those kinds of guns throwaway guns, so that if you shoot at someone for no good reason, you can just put it down and not get traced back to you. So these cops proclaimed they were drunk, and that's why they did what they did. But I think there's any evidence that they were drunk. And I think the evidence all points to that it was another assassination attempt of Tupac. Now, there's more evidence than that, but you can see the book for the other evidence. The next attack after that was at the Quad recording studio in New York, and that was following what happened a few months after the Atlanta incident. Someone came into Tupac's life named Haitian. His name was Jacques Ignan. He had all kinds of aliases, but he was known in Tupac's songs as Haitian Jack. And Tupac would say he knew he was working for the feds because all the evidence would come out later and Tupac's trial lawyer, Michael Warren, would get Jacques Ignan's rap sheet, which showed, he said, dozens and dozens of high-level charges up and down the East Coast, all dismissed, which he said is a sure sign of a police intelligence agent. So Jacques Ignan set him up with a woman in a club. That woman proceeded to unzip his pants and admittedly in court kissed his penis in the middle of a dance floor in New York. Now, you know, other witnesses said she gave him a blowjob on the dance floor. But either way, they then went back to her place and had sex that night. She called his hotel room and said, "Can I want to have sex with you again?" And a few nights later, they got together again, and he fooled around with her. And she then charged Tupac and his cohorts, Jacques Ignan and another guy, mystery guy, who escaped the whole situation, was a friend of Jacques Ignant's, with a forced sodomy, an attempted forced sodomy, and assault, and other things. So police get the recording from the hotel, the voicemail, and they proceed to, you know, they take it into custody, and then they say they accidentally erased it. That and much more evidence shows that the whole thing was a setup. Now, the case went to court about a year later, and the case was going so badly in court that the prosecutor offered for there to be a mistrial. Tupac, you know, refused that offer and said, "You know, I don't want a mistrial. I want to clear my name." So jury went out to make a final decision. While the jury was out, the night the jury was out making a final decision, Tupac's called to a New York recording studio lobby by a man named James Henchman Rosemont. And James Henchman Rosemont was associate of Jacques Ignant's. So Tupac was, you know, knew, it was a little scared about it. And so he asked for tons of cash to be offered immediately for him to just lay down, you know, maybe a line or two in another rapper's song. And He said he was so stoned that night, though, that he should have been more wary of the whole situation. So he goes to the recording studio, sees some guy out front dressed in fatigues, thought it was one of the kind of guys bodyguarding Biggie and Puffy. But the guy didn't acknowledge him at all. He says if he wasn't so stoned, he would have realized this is something strange is going on here, that a black man doesn't acknowledge Tupac here, and everyone knows Tupac's face. And so he goes in there and proceeds to be held up by gunmen. The gunmen, according to doctor's affidavit, put a bullet in Tupac to send him to the ground. And while he was face down on the ground, they put two bullets in his head, you know, typical assassination style. Now, police maintain that it was just a random mugging in the middle of Times Square at 11 p.m. at night, in the most well-lit area in the world at 11 p.m. at night. But they proceeded to take some of Tupac's jewels and other people's jewels, but they left a diamond-encrusted Rolex watch that Haitian Jack had given Tupac on Tupac's wrist. So then after that, the security guard had a videotape of the incident and offered it to the police, and the police rejected it and said they just were closing the case. And so that's just some of the multiple factors in that incident that show this was a U.S. intelligence assassination attempt, probably number 4 or 5, okay? So it later came out that somebody said, he said very publicly, it was in all the news, that James Henchman Rosemont had offered him, I think it was $10,000 or $20,000, and all the jewels he can get from Tupac and the other people to kill Tupac, to attack Tupac. And so people thought it was just because of some kind of rivalry or whatever else. But I have the documents right here that show that James Henchman Rosemont was already talking to prosecution and the government. At that time, he was already talking to people about things, and we don't know what exactly he was talking about, but I argue, of course, it was, you know, another U.S. intelligence attempt on Tupac's life. And, of course, the final incident was when Tupac ended up getting found guilty in that sexual assault trial, but he was only found guilty for touching this woman's, Ayanna Jackson's, butt against her will. Okay, he was found not guilty of attempting sodomy, you know, forced sodomy, assisting forced sodomy, gun possession, every other charge he was found not guilty of. He was only found guilty of touching her butt against her will, and this is someone who they both admitted in court that there was consensual sex between them. Okay, so for that small charge, now Haitian Jack Ignat pled guilty to the exact same charge, and he got a misdemeanor. You know, Tupac received 1.5 to 4.5 years in jail in a maximum security prison for touching a woman's butt against her will, who he had consensual sex with. So Tupac goes to jail. I argue that penal coercion tactics were used against him. I show the evidence that every one of what Amnesty International called this penal coercion was used against Tupac. Amnesty International says these tactics were used against political prisoners. And they said it was the closest thing we have right now to brainwashing, and it really messes people, you know, people's minds up in prison. And I argue they're all that I show evidence of all the tactics being used on Tupac and more. And I show the evidence of why their reason, their goals were to get him to sign with Death Row Records, and to get him to believe what U.S. intelligence created as the East Coast versus West Coast rap war, that Biggie and Puffy set up his shooting in that New York recording studio lobby. Tupac was friends with Biggie and Puffy. He was particularly friends with Biggie, and Biggie went to visit him in the hospital after he was shot. So here he was coming out. He was stuck in jail. He was there for 10, 11 months. His management, Watai Tanahimba and Interscope, offered about $1.4 million for bail out of a $3 million bail. $3 million was put on Tupac for bail. And they raised $1.4 million, and usually you only need 10% of bail. If you know the legal system, you only need 10% of bail to get a bail bond. And they came up with almost half of it, and they weren't given a bail bond for Tupac. Death Row comes in with $1.5 million. and they get Tupac out within several days because they said they'd do it if Tupac signed a death row. And Tupac had said that, and Tiny Himba had said that death row had been making offers again and again for the last year or two for Tupac to join them, and they never knew why they were making such lucrative offers and trying to get him to join so badly, especially since they were under Interscope, they were kind of connected with Interscope anyway. So it didn't make sense to them, but him and Watani Himba, his business manager, who was the security director for the New African People's Organization, knew that there was something very fishy, very shady going on at death row. They just didn't know what. So Watani Himba said, you know, that Tupac cried on his shoulder, saying, "I know I'm selling my soul to the devil by joining death row." And he's crying on Watani's shoulder because Watani said, "If you join death row, we have to part ways. I can't be connected to you anymore because I can't jeopardize the New African People's Organization if you join Death Row Records, because Death Row Records could bring our organization down, and because we don't know what's going on there, but there's something fishy going on there." So as soon as Tupac signs Death Row, within a week he's let out of jail, goes with Death Row. Suge Knight and Dave Kenner offer him weed and alcohol immediately, even though Tupac had said in interviews he thought he had become addicted to weed, and he was lifeless and numb, getting drunk and stoned all the time. And he wanted to stay away from it all. And I argue that Death Row messed his head up even more and got him to produce the most negative lyrics he's ever produced, you know, with Death Row Records in his double album, you know, All Eyes on Me. I'm sorry, yeah, All Eyes on Me. And it wasn't until he was finally getting himself out of that state of being drunk and stoned so much and getting out of Death Row and said, you know, he's done with Death Row. He started his own label, Euthanasia Records. I'm sorry, it's called Euthanasia Records. And he started his own film company. And a very activist woman named Yasmin Fula, who was the wife of former Bronx Black Panther Sekou Odinga, was his was head of his record company and was organizing things for him. And Yafu Fula was one of his backup rappers in the Outlaws. And that was Yasmin Fula's son and Sekou Odinga's son. And at some point, about 9 days before Tupac was shot, he fired the real head of Death Row Records, which was Dave Kenner, a white lawyer. And after firing him, he was scared. And he was scared to go to Las Vegas that night of the Mike Tyson fight, even though usually, you know, he'd been to former Mike Tyson fights because Mike Tyson loved Tupac. And he was actually had a court order that he was supposed to do a benefit concert in Vegas that night. But a guy named Kevin Hackey, one of his bodyguards, said, "Don't go to Vegas, Tupac. You know, go to Atlanta. Go be with your extended family. Don't go to Vegas." And he wasn't sure why, but he was going to listen to Kevin Hackey. It turns out Kevin Hackey admitted publicly that he was also being paid by the FBI and was inserted as, you know, one of the bodyguards for Tupac. And I argue that Kevin Hackey turned on the FBI, and Hackey said that he was put in jail. He was framed and put in jail after that incident. He was immediately fired by death row for telling Tupac not to go to Vegas. But Tupac ended up saying, "Well, I guess I have to go to Vegas because this court order for me to do a benefit concert in Vegas." So he ended up going anyway, despite what Hackey was telling him. And that's where he got, you know, shot and, you know, died within about 6 days. And so in Vegas, there was, now Death Row Records had dozens of police officers working for them. A person assigned to Biggie Smalls' murder was named Russell Poole. He's a high-level white police detective who got himself assigned to that investigation because of another case he had stumbled upon. And he ended up finding dozens of his fellow officers working at all levels of Death Row Records. When he went to his superiors and said, "What are they doing here?" they told him, "You can consider them covert agents." He didn't know what to make of it all, but he ended up concluding after his investigation that his fellow officers killed Biggie Smalls in order to hide, cover up their murder of Tupac Shakur. And that's, you know, all the evidence points that way.
Man, that's a lot of information. And this is all within the book, as well as there's a documentary online,
right,
about this, right, on YouTube?
Right. And the book's titled The FBI War on Tupac Shakur and Black Leaders. And the subtitle of the book is U.S. intelligence's murderous targeting of Tupac, MLK, Malcolm, Panthers, Hendrix, Marley, rappers, and linked ethnic leftists.
Thank you. Before we let you go, I'd like to also like ask you a couple more questions. Now,
sure.
Suge Knight, do you believe Suge Knight was a at the very least, a low-level FBI informant?
Yes.
Okay, and does the book get into that?
Yes, it shows the evidence of that.
Okay. And so, and it also obviously gets into, you know, Tupac's murder and Biggie's murder as being state-sponsored assassinations, pretty much.
Yes. Now, Biggie's murder was more what you would call, U.S. intelligence calls collateral damage.
Mm-hmm.
It was done, Biggie was not political, but of course he was a very creative, brilliant creative guy. He just wasn't political, but I argue that they killed Biggie in order to make Tupac's murder look like part of this, manufactured East Coast versus West Coast rivalry, and then to use that same excuse as a cover up for Jam Master Jay's murder, or assassination, and for murderous attacks on other rappers.
And the hip hop units, you talk about these hip hop units that were trained by the LAPD and the NYPD.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about the murders that within rap that started to, that began after the training, some training that went on in Miami.
Right. Miami Herald had an article about that Miami's police unit had a special training by the New York Police Department, and it was a hip-hop unit, and they said it was to investigate the violence in rap. And then they had a timeline at the end of the article of the violence that occurred in rap. And what they didn't comment on was the fact that the violence started after the training, not before the training, all the violent incidents that they showed. And so I argue that other journalists said that they found out that these rap units, and these articles in these rap units came out in other places, in New York Magazine, for example, and other places. Now, these other articles mostly said that they were just doing racial, rap profiling. But one journalist came out with the fact that they're actually using COINTELPRO tactics with their rap units. And we all, all the evidence is there from the FBI documents that COINTELPRO tactics include murder. So, and COINTELPRO tactics is political targeting, it's targeting leftists. So that's what comes out when you look at, some of this targeting. That when people start getting, when some of these rappers start getting involved in activism, such as Russell Simmons' Hip Hop Summit Action Network, which had taken on a 12-point plan, not that dissimilar from the Black Panther Party's 12-point plan. Of course, they're not radical as the Black Panther Party, but they tried to get more left-wing in what they were shooting for, and they had people like Kwasi Mfume, had the Congressional Black Caucus as part of their board. They had Manning Marable, Columbia University professors, who was a member of the Democratic Socialist Party as part of their board, and a number of good black leaders, and of course top black rappers as part of their board too. And when some of these top, selling rappers became part of that group, they came under attack. And when they started doing anything that was left-wing at all, they came under attack from a rap union, I argue.
Right. Where can, John, we really appreciate the time you've taken with us today.
Sure.
Where can people go right now to, is there a website? And then also, secondly, is there a way people can contact you that you feel comfortable, putting out there if folks want to contact you to perhaps come to their organization and do a book signing and discussion about this book and the research?
Sure. Thanks, Salman. They can go to FBIWarOnTupac.com. That's my website. And they can email me at jlpotash, P-O-T-A-S-H, @gmail.com. They want to contact me about any speaking engagements.
Okay, and the next book is coming out in November.
And I just also want to say they're welcome to get my DVD and just show it for free, or they want to raise money too. I don't care. That's fine. to show for you know, to raise money for their group or their organization too. The next book is called Drugs as Weapons Against Us, the CIA's murderous targeting of SDS, Panthers, Hendrix, Lenin, Cobain, Tupac, and other leftists. And that's coming out in November on Trine Day Press. And that just shows how these same, you know, U.S. intelligence murderous targeting was used against white leftists too, and particularly against white musicians, but that they used musicians, such as the ones I mentioned, to first promote certain drugs, but then to murder these musicians when they started getting away from the drugs and getting more into their leftist politics. And I show all the evidence of that, of how that happened. And they mercilessly targeted, of course, Students for Democratic Society, the top anti-war country this country's ever seen and for student organizing. And, of course, the Black Panthers, as I argue. But I show how drugs were used against Black Panther Huey Newton and against Fannie Shakur to undermine her and her activism, and how they've been viciously attacked, particularly when they start getting away from the drugs and back into the activism. But that's another part of the book.
Thank you for your time. That's John Potash, author of FBI War on Tupac and Black Leaders. Please, go to the website. He told you, check it out. It's fascinating. It's an incredibly well researched and put together book. The documentary as well. So I really implore folks to go there and to check it out. And if anyone knows the legacy of COINTELPRO, that it shouldn't be hard. It shouldn't be some kind of incredulous thing that people think that this is based on the history of COINTELPRO and the history of U.S. government organizations and organs destabilizing, and attacking leftist black leaders as well as other leftist leaders.
Yeah, I mean, activists got into, they broke into an FBI office and stole all the documents that has found out about COINTELPRO. So the counterintelligence program or COINTELPRO was just documented in these thousands and thousands of pages. So we know about that, but they found ways to hide the more current FBI documents. Now, I filed a Freedom of Information Act for the FBI pages on Tupac Shakur, and they said, the woman at the Justice Department said, I know that you have to pay for those copies to be made of his FBI file. And I said, well, how many pages are there, to pay for it? And she said, I'm not allowed to tell you that. So then when I got to talking to her more about exactly how many pages I need to pay for and how that was copied and everything else, she said, well, there's 4,000 pages in there, so you have to pay over, and it's 10 cents a page, so you got to pay over $400 for them. So she slipped on that. But when I paid for the 4,000 pages, they only sent me 99 pages. They said for national security reasons. And even those 99 pages were highly redacted, with big black marker over numbered many paragraphs.
Wow. So thanks a lot, and look forward to having you on again in the future, especially to discuss the next book. Thanks so much, John.
Thanks so much for having me on, Solomon.
No problem. That's John Potash, as I said before, author of FBI War on Tupac Shakur and Black Leaders. I'm Solomon Kamajan, host of Critical Insight on Your World News. And as we say at Your World News, journalism and activism are not mutually exclusive. Peace.
I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and burned it.